So it's my great pleasure now to interview and have a conversation with three nurses that I really admire, and I think they are much more courageous than I could ever be. And coincidentally, each of them have worked or are still working with MSF. And so today we're going to be talking about COVID-19, but each of these amazing nurses have had experience in other epidemics and other emergency settings. So I thought we might start off just by asking each of them to introduce themselves and really talk about how COVID-19 fits in their other experience of epidemics or emergencies. So Casey, we might start with you.
Great. Hi. My name is Casey Higgox. I am currently working for Doctors Without Borders, really helping our field teams prepare for COVID-19 from an infection prevention and control standpoint. And as you may or may not know, I responded to the Ebola outbreak in Sierra Leone in 2014. I have also responded to measles, meningitis, cholera outbreaks with Doctors Without Borders. And so outbreaks and emergencies and times of uncertainty and where action needs to be swift is definitely something I am used to, but this is different. This is a global pandemic that has spread incredibly rapidly. And I think it's also interesting to remember that today we have a different kind of connectedness with social media. And then it becomes really difficult to start filtering out true information that is accurate, scientifically driven, evidence-based. So I know that healthcare workers around the world are really inundated right now. And I think that's a real struggle for our teams all over the world in Africa, Asia, and the Middle East. And I'm not working in a U.S. hospital system, but I have, dear friends that are ICU nurses and ER nurses, and I'm hearing the same things from them, the difficulties in keeping up with the information and knowing what information they can trust. But I think one of the things that I keep trying to go back to is from a nursing leadership perspective, when we look at the hierarchy of controls within infection control, which is, of course, my area of expertise, there's administrative controls, there's engineering controls, and then PPE is the lowest, least effective level of controls. And so those administrative controls are the clear policies and procedures that are based on the data about how COVID is spread. Good staff training. So, any process you put in place, any change to normal practices, you have to have something written and clear and really good staff training. And you need the leadership, the management, and the monitoring of that implementation of those new processes. And if we just start with that, just those administrative controls, then we'll be in a good place to provide leadership in our healthcare organizations.
Thanks, Casey. And Nadja, let's hear a little bit about you.
Hello, everybody. I'm Nadja Andrade. I'm a PhD student at Hopkins, and I also work with Doctors Without Borders in Chechnya and South Sudan and Syria most recently. I've served both clinically as a critical care nurse specialist and also as an educator for one of our critical care courses, which it's basically a group of us who will go to the front lines and give the nursing staff on the field basic critical care concepts from assessment to utilizing oxygen masks or how many liters goes in an oxygen mask and things that will help them face the challenges of caring for critically ill patients in resource depleted areas, which is, I think, a big focus of the course. As far as COVID-19 and how that has compared to my previous experiences, I think what is was striking to me working in Brooklyn and Kings County, which is one of the hardest hit counties in the world, is just the sheer number of patients. It is, the health system is not able to absorb that many people at the same time. And with that, nurses have to be creative and they have to find ways of providing the care to the patients with limited resources, and most importantly, limited amount of people. And I think that for me would be a lesson for the future. I think our leadership has done great work in regards to providing the ICU beds, providing the ventilators. However, an ICU bed without a nurse is just another place of suffering. So we need to understand that in order to face the next pandemic or even this pandemic, we really need to invest in education of nurses. And that has been my passion. And not only in resource depleted areas, but now we understand that investing in nursing's training to care for more critically ill patients, that's very important. So I think for me that was the biggest message, that we will need and we need to be now more creative regarding our staffing and how are we protecting our staff, going back to what Casey was talking about. If our staff gets sick, that's another, you know, bed that's not, there's another patient who will not have the care that they need. So I think that's very important. And in regards to the way that we used in creative ways of providing care for our patients, I think that there were some important lessons. And I think the most important one is it's teamwork, understanding that it takes the tasks will be done in a different way, in a more collaborative way. And I think that nurses everywhere can understand that in times of pandemic, we have each other and relying on each other's expertises and relying on each other's strengths, it's very important. So I think the year of the nurse, it came on a good year because it made me realize that we are indeed the breathing soul of hospital systems. And without nurses to staff those beds and to be able to manage the ventilators and things, it becomes very challenging to provide the care that people need and deserve.
Thank you, Nadja. Debbie.
Hi. So my name's Debbie, and I also am a PhD student at Hopkins, and I also have worked with Doctors Without Borders in measles, cholera outbreaks, and the Ebola outbreak. And I also just was working in a COVID overflow, the Convention Center Boston Hope, where we took patients, so we weren't the ICU. Once patients were stabilized in the ICU, they came to us if they were still on oxygen or had no place to go for quarantine, or they were in a family situation that we couldn't send them home. And so, and because I've shifted from working in the ER to doing more public health, it was interesting, A, to work in a military facility that was set up by the military when I've only ever done humanitarian work. But also working with physical, we had to create everything from ground up. So design all the procedures, and we had to limit who we admitted at first until we got an ICU bed ready and a code room, et cetera, things like this. Also a lot of new grads who haven't been able to get work were being hired by the convention center. And so I found my responsibility having new grads, their first job ever out of nursing school, having to do PPE. And I mean, the courage, and also just, we all remember being our first job, how nervous we were, you know, you're suddenly, it's your responsibility. And, but I think the multidisciplinary team working with we needed case managers, we needed physical therapists, we needed occupational therapists, we needed the doctors. So it was a full team effort to get somebody safe to go home or find somewhere safe for them to go home. We had healthcare for the homeless on the other side. So we were also dealing with homeless individuals that would crash and then come over to our side. So we were dealing a lot with, there's a lot more with COVID than just the virus, but there's all the social issues that come with it that I'm really hoping wakes people up to. We need to start in the community with public health nursing, with prevention, with having safety nets for people so that, you know, they don't crash through the floorboards if a pandemic happens again. And this will be a big challenge. And I think going back to other things that both of you said, in terms of us as nurses, two things. One is I noticed that, I mean, I'm one that has a crush on Dr. Fauci like everyone, but I wish he had a nurse with him. It's always Dr. So-and-so. So how about a nurse up there? Because we are the ones on the front lines risking our lives in every one of these epidemics that I've been at. And often even more so than the doctors. But again, we're a team. So why not be a team at the top as experts? Because I feel we have a holistic perspective that needs to be communicated that that I think would just balance things out. Otherwise it can sometimes become, we sometimes lose sight of what's really needed. And I've forgotten what the other thing is, but anyway, that's that.
Well, you know, I think Debbie, you've made an excellent point, particularly in the context of today and the announcements around remdesivir, which we're all really excited about, but we know that is just a drop in the ocean about this pandemic and what needs to happen. So one of the things in this course that we're really getting people to try and think about is beyond the level of patient. And I think traditionally that's how we've been trained, is to think about that one-on-one relationship. But, you know, Casey's made an excellent point in infection control, and is this administrative leadership, what the administrative decisions can be. So I'd be interested in hearing from each of you, what are some of the kind of advice you would give to people like Debbie? You've just been setting up this field hospital, this, you know, what basically would be your advice to nurses who are new to this area? Because I think for a generation, there's never been anything, in at least I've been a nurse for over 40 years, that has been anything like this. So what advice would you give to new nurses or nurses working in the field to enable them to more effectively manage in the pandemic? Maybe Debbie, I'll start with you.
Well, I think the first thing that comes to mind is a standardized, I mean, we might have slightly different PPE, but a standardized procedure. And with MSF, I mean, you know, it was the Ebola outbreak, which in one way, Ebola is much harder to catch, but also much more deadly. But we had someone that guided us through, that guided you through donning and doffing, getting into your PPE and getting out. And Dr. Farley mentions that that's happening, and I know that's happening at Hopkins, but at the Boston Hospital, that wasn't happening. And when they tried to put things in place, they got a lot of pushback from the nurses because everyone wants to do it their own. They say they know how to do it, but having been trained so stringent, and it was surprising to me in a military hospital because I thought we would be regimented. And some things I do think need to be regimented. And I think having somebody there to guide you through, whether you want it or not, because they had people there who just sat there and just watched us, you know, they didn't want to interfere. And I think that's part of a postmodern society. And the other thing, when there was the concern of the Ebola here, even though for those of us that went and worked in West Africa, we knew it wouldn't be a concern here because of running water and Clorox and, you know, infection control procedures that were here that weren't in West Africa. But I think some nurses, they feel they didn't sign up for this. And so anxious, another couple of friends of mine have been hospitalized during this time without COVID, and they said the nurses are so stressed and anxious and it makes them anxious. And of course then they're, you know, which doesn't help. And then whereas when we had the Ebola concerns here, you could sign up to work if an Ebola patient came in, you had the choice. And here, like really a lot of nurses don't have a choice. And that's difficult because I think there should be a choice. But that choice needs to be based on science, not fear. Because I think people keep forgetting that one of the main reasons we're doing the social distancing and the staying at home is to not overburden hospitals by spreading the virus. Like most people who are young and fit, I mean, this is generalized, they'll get sick, but they won't die. But to not overburden the hospitals, we need to step back. So those are two things, I think, is how, as nurses, do we allow the room for people to step back if they don't feel safe, or to say that they don't feel safe? And how can we bring in regimented protocols in a postmodern society?
Great, thank you. Nadja?
I think a lot of what Debbie said reflects my thoughts, and more specifically regarding education and the anxiety that some nurses have felt caring for critically ill patients who are in their wards where before they have never cared for somebody so sick. And that causes a lot of anxiety, a lot of fear, and feelings of inadequacy as you are not providing the best care for the patient. And what I want a nurse to know is it okay to feel that way? It is something new. It is something that threatens us psychologically in many ways. However, I want them to know that if you don't have a leadership in your hospital that is already structured to listen to your input and take in all the advice that you have for them regarding the training that you need to be, you need to speak up. It's not okay to care for a ventilated patient if you're not comfortable with the ventilator. That's not good for you, that's not good for the patient, that's not good for anyone. So make sure you step up and say, hey, I am not comfortable, I have never done this before. However, if you give me the training, I will step in and I'll be glad to serve. The same with medications that you have never given before, and now you've been called upon to provide these medications for the patients. You're not comfortable. Say, hey, I am here and I'm willing to work. However, the situation doesn't make me comfortable. I would like to have the training, and I would do my best to learn all these new drugs and how to safely give them. However, until I get to that point, it's very challenging to me and not safe to the patients to do so. That's the time for you to be inadequate for yourself. And in being inadequate for yourself, you'll be inadequate for your patient, because the more prepared you are, the better care you give to your patients. I think that's the biggest challenge many nurses are facing out there. This is very new for doctors, nurses, respiratory therapists, for everybody. And feeling like you're not empowered or equipped with the knowledge would put you in a place of powerlessness. And that can have harmful effects on you as a professional and as an individual. And we want to avoid that. We want our nurses to get out of this pandemic stronger than they came in. And I think being an advocate for yourself and having a leadership that understands that, it's paramount. So I think that would be my biggest sharing my knowledge of what I saw during this pandemic, and really speaking to those who will become leaders one day. And if we face a pandemic again, know that your staff will rely tremendously on your leadership and the decisions you make. And if you are there, and if you're giving them the resources they need, the nurses will show up to work. They will show up to work. So be a good advocate for yourself. I think that would be my suggestion.
Thank you, Nadja. And Casey?
Man, I mean, Nadja and Deborah have just hit the nail on the head. I'm not sure I can add much, but I agree, especially with what you're saying about, you know, I think it's almost mentorship. I think within every healthcare setting, we need to be identifying nurse mentors who are providing that support to our colleagues that may not have the same knowledge and skills and experience as we do. So that's definitely something. Find a mentor. And, you know, it kind of reminds me in lifeguarding, if you're saving someone who's drowning and there's a rock and there's current, you actually put the person that's drowning in between you and the rock so that you don't get hurt and then you both drowned. It's kind of the same concept. We have to protect ourselves and make sure that we have the confidence and knowledge in what we're doing. I also think that I agree, standardization, training, you know, asking for those standard operating procedures. If it's not written down, go to the boss and say, no, I need something in writing to follow. This is important that I am very aware of what's expected. But aside from then just reading and doing, one of the things I really try to remind our teams is to ask the why to the what. You know why you're wearing the mask and the eye protection. Know why you're wearing the gown. Know why you're wearing the mask. If you really understand COVID transmission and the why, and this doesn't just apply to infection control, but then, you know, you'll be prepared to use your critical thinking skills in that process that's not written down, because we can't write down every single thing that we do every day, right? There can't be a protocol for everything. So I think really learning the why will help you feel confident and safe.
Even what, if we want to look at it as an opportunity as nurses, we are the front, we are also being seen as, we always have been the front line. People are cheering in New York, you know, people are calling us heroes in a way that I don't think I haven't seen in my nursing career. And certainly after Ebola, we were not seen as heroes coming back. We were seen as quite the opposite. But also, it makes me think we have a responsibility to be exemplars in the community. And just for example, one, I was on a call with people that weren't nurses, and one of them said, you know, I went walking my dog and I'm wearing my mask, as I'm asked in our state, and these nurses came out of this particular facility and none of them are wearing masks. And probably they're sick of wearing them, because I mean, you know, yeah. I've got a rash on my face and everything. But it freaked them out, and they said, but they're nurses and they know what's going on. And it just made me think, you know, again, I want us to have more of a public face as well. There's our concerns, but I do feel we need to be exemplars in the community, not just, you know, Facebook of pictures of ninja nurses, but to be really heroic and actually be publicly educating the public as well. Not just within our hospitals, but being part of the education of the public, really being public health nurses and being leaders in that as well. I want us to be leaders in this.
Absolutely.
Not just doing the good work.
Well, thank you so very much. But I'm going to stop recording, but I want to continue the conversation. But your comments have been phenomenal, and you know, and you are heroes in my book.